Title of today's message, where's Tim? Did he leave already, Adam? Oh, he's getting coffee. This is not time for a coffee break, Tim. I'm getting ready. Yeah. You got it. All right. Well, stick it up there. Not in your own strengths. The title of this, today's message, and you see up there is striving for what God wants to bless us with through grace and mercy. What I'm trying to say to you is that God does want to bless you. And he wants to do it through grace and mercy, and too often we're busy striving, trying to get it our own way. And that's what I want to talk to you about today. That's certainly what God has laid upon my heart. And this is actually a lot from the Old Testament. I want to share a story with you, a story of grace given to a striving, conniving little weasel. Okay? I mean that. That's how we would see him today. Although he lived a long time ago and he's one of the patriarchs. He worked hard at, manipulated as much as he could his way to the top. Only discovered that once he got ahead of everybody else, the price he paid to get there wasn't really what he was looking for. And I think if you talk to anybody who tries to do things on their own, in their own steam, and try to get ahead in this world, that when they get there, they find out it's not where they really want to be, or at least it sure isn't what they thought it would be. And I think that happens to us in the church too. We too often want to put our hands on the plow or take our part of the yoke that we put our heads in with Christ and start trying to lead it in a different kind of way, because we think the path that we're on isn't as easy as the path that we would like to be on. Amen? We all do it. I think it's part of what the scripture was trying to help us understand, is that when we pick up our cross daily, is really that we surrender our will, we surrender our desires, we surrender what we want back unto God every day, each and every day. And there's a reason that the Bible instructs us to do that, because it's a war we fight. I don't know why we like having control, but we tend to want to trust ourselves more than God. Well, I just want you to know that conniving your way up the ladder is not going to get you where what you want. In case you haven't figured it out by now, who I'm really talking about is the brother of a set of twins, Jacob and Esau. And Esau's this, if he was in today's standards, he'd probably be playing for the NFL or doing some kind of sportsman. He'd be in Sports Illustrated, and he'd be teaching us all the tricks of the trade on how to hunt those deer that are in my backyard. By the way, I enjoy those greatly. Thanks for calling me here, John. Every day. Debbie says, you get a kick out of that. We got about 6 deer coming every day, morning and the evening. And they come up by the crab apple tree. I just enjoy them. Esau was the hunter. Esau is interesting because he does an instant replay, if you were in sports, of the great fall. I don't know if you ever thought about it much. You remember Eve had him? They traded some spiritual peace for an apple. Okay, kind of just said, you know what, I'm not sure that all this spiritual stuff is that important. Satan convinced them, and they ate, and they brought death on themselves. But Esau is sort of the same way. His twin brother, Jacob, is an interesting character. His name means supplanter, means he's going to kind of get you out and put himself in that place. And when the twins were born, before the twins were born, actually God spoke to their mother, Rebecca, and said, you know, there'll be 2 great nations come from these boys, these twins. You're having twins. You know, she was wondering what all the turmoil was about. She said, you're having more than one. What a double portion, double blessing. And Jacob is delivered, his bird, clutching the heel of his brother. Okay? Gotta have what you have and want what you want. And so the older brother is born, and the firstborn gets just a whole lot of things that the rest of the children in those days didn't get. But Jacob, as he grew up, wanted that. He wanted spiritual blessings. Esau, we're told that Esau was daddy's boy. Jacob was mama's boy. Okay, that happens in families. Happened in my family. My younger brother was actually the sports guy, and my dad just thought he was the coolest thing. He and dad, they got along like this. And I'm a mama's boy. Okay, that sounds weird, you know, but truth is truth. Amen? Yep. Don't have to like it for it to be true. And I was a mama's boy. And as we grew up, they would go watch my brother's football games as he played football. And just, you know, it was just, he's a cat's meow. And I was left at home babysitting the baby brother who was born 15 years afterwards. I was 15 years old when my baby brother was born. And so I'd be the babysitter left at home. I kind of relate to Jacob a little bit, you know. Maybe some of you can. Or maybe some of you are in the family and you're like the Esau, you know? Every family has it, doesn't it? And so Esau and Jacob are out there, and I would guess, just because I don't think it was a brand new concept for Esau, I would guess that somewhere along the line, as brothers do, you know, Jacob's jabbing him, you know, you get the birthright, you're the firstborn, I really want that. How about let's make a deal? My brother and I used to do that all the time. He collected trading cards, and we would make deals with trading cards. We'd make deals. We played, I'm dating myself, and some of you younger folks don't know what that is, but I had a Johnny West and a G.I. Joe. We traded dolls. Any of you remember Johnny West? Yeah, I had a horse. Yeah. I had one of those. We had a Jeep for it and a horse trailer. Yeah. Man, it was cool. Got it for Christmas. My brother wanted my horse. Well, I forget what that horse was. Thunderbolt or something like that. And we were always trading. I think there was some of that going on with Jacob and his brother, his twin brother. They weren't identical twins, by the way, obviously. Esau was ruddy and had lots of hair. You know, picture him, one of those guys, you see guys, you know, the hair's kind of coming out of their collar. You know what I mean? It's growing out of their ears. They need to know what a groomer is for. You know what I'm talking about? You girls do, don't you? Most of us guys don't really pay that much attention. That's kind of like Esau. Jacob's, you know, I just picture him this smooth, I got smooth hands. I didn't always have smooth hands, by the way. I used to work in a factory, but now I'm just a preacher. Got baby soft hands. Anyhow, there's one particular day, you know the story. Esau's out hunting. And he comes back, and it must have been out, gone a long time. Missed a few meals and probably feeling kind of weak, and his belly's making more noise than a wild boar, okay? And it's like, oh, I'm famished. And his brother is scheming, and he comes back, and he's ready for the moment. He's going to seize the moment. And he has, I did a little research, lentil. I think of lentil beans. The research said they were more like a pea in the Middle East. I don't know. Some kind of stew. Probably had some meat in it. Some domestic meat, you know. I don't know. Maybe some lamb chops. I don't know. But brother made a stew, and Esau comes in and thinks he's gonna collapse. He's gonna die of starvation. And Jacob says, "You know what?" He said, "Give me some of that before I faint of exhaustion." And Brother says, I tell you what, I'll give you some, but you got to give me your birthright. And Esau's like, it's not such a big deal. I'm hungry. And he trades his birthright. But Jacob's really, he's on the ball. He's almost like a lawyer. By the way, for what it's worth, I told you last week I'd make a good lawyer. You don't get, before Jesus got a hold of me, you know, you just wouldn't get over me. I'd get even. You wouldn't win. But Jacob's ready for this, and he said to him, he said, "Not, I don't want to just hear you say it. I want you to swear. There's no taking this back. I want your birthright. Well, I need a birthright for. I'm going to die today if I don't eat something." And so he trades his birthright. As he does that, some time has passed, and if you're in the scriptures, that's the 25th chapter of Genesis, by the way. Some time has passed, and you get into, I think it's the 28th chapter, maybe, no, 30. I have it written here. Well, I guess. Chapter 32. I'm going to jump into 32. I want to say this to you, though, before I do. When he gets into chapter 32, Jacob is now going to deceive his own father. Not only does he want the birthright, but he wants the blessing that goes with it. Tim, I think the next point up here is that, go ahead, put it up there for me, Tim. Are you drinking coffee, not paying attention to notes I gave you? Huh? Did you break the machine again? I just want to say to you, it always starts with a birthright. That's not very bright back there. Well, you can see that all right. It always starts with a birthright. Birthrights are pretty important. And our relationship with God starts with a birthright. It matters. Birthright. Big deal. We'll talk about that just a little bit. But Jesus said to Nicodemus, just to make my point, "Truly, truly, I say to you, unless a man is born again, he cannot enter the kingdom of heaven." And he goes on to Nicodemus. He says it about three different times in three different ways, Nicodemus having this conversation with Jesus. Birthright's a big deal to God. Being born again, being born into the family, it's a big deal. And God wants us to understand it. So it always starts there. The birthright for Jacob in his day, it secured to him, the birthright secured to him who possessed it. The firstborn got it naturally. Jacob took it from his brother or stole it from his brother in a roundabout way. But here's what it did for you. It gave you a superior rank in your family. It gave you a double portion of the inheritance. John, you see a lot of funerals. A lot of squabbling goes on who gets what that's left over. But the birthright gives you a double portion of that, of the parental inheritance. It gives you a priestly office. I think that's interesting in the family. And it gives you the promise of the seed in which all nations of the earth were to be blessed, at least for Jacob. I would just share with you the blessing of God, this blessing that Jacob won, and what he did. Let me share the story with you. What he did is that his dad, this is sometime later, his dad is getting old enough, thinks he's about to kick the bucket. And you like the way I dress this thing up? He's about to kick the bucket, and so he calls his firstborn, like he's supposed to, Esau, and he says to him, he says, "You know what, Esau, I'd like you to go out there and do it one more time for me, just one great meal." Isn't it cool? It's always over a meal. And he sends Esau out, and he says, "You know, I want you to come back, cook it up." Well, Jacob's mom, you know, the mama's boy, she hears all of this, and Esau's out and he's hunting, looking for whatever wild game he's going to bring in for his dad. He's out doing it. His mom moves in and talks to Jacob and says, here's a plan. She helps him. And so they devise a plan, and they go in, and they're going to deceive his dad. Flat out lie. Okay? Because he wants to be blessed. All right? He's going to make sure he gets the blessing. And it reminds me often of as we travel this thing called life, people think that God's love, and God does. God loves people. He just does. Sinners and saints alike, he loves them. But we don't all get the blessing. See, there's no blessing without a birthright. Does that make sense? No birthright, no blessing. Which means is that we all have to come to God at some place, and we need to, the way you get the birthright is we repent of our sins and we confess that, you know what, I've been doing this thing all my own way, under my own steam, and I've sinned. And that's when we get the birthright, and when we get the birthright, then we're blessed. But not Jacob. He thinks he can get it some other way than through God. He's going to get it under his own steam. And so he tries to get the birthright, and he tries to get the blessing, and you can't have one. In fact, Esau came in and found out what they did. They deceived Dad. They actually put a coat on him, you know, so he'd be hairy. And I don't know if Dad was kind of saying, let me see under your collar and see if there's, you know, but Dad was doing that, and he says, you know, and he's pretty much blind at this point. And he says, you know, you smell like Esau, but you feel like Jacob. And Jacob's busy saying, hey, I'm Esau. And he gets Dad's blessing. But not through God. Now, it's interesting that God told his mama, which I'm sure Dad knew too, that this would eventually work out for Jacob, but Jacob wasn't willing to do it God's way. He was a weasel. That's why I called him a weasel, okay? And so the blessing I would share with you is no blessing, really, if it's on your own steam. As mom and son conspire to get the blessing, and they thus deceive Dad, and supplants his big brother of the blessing, and the deceiver is going to afterwards be deceived. So what he does is he gets this blessing, big brother, who by the way can take him. I remember the day when I figured out that I could no longer take my little brother. I stopped picking on him. My little brother's bigger than me. In case you haven't figured out, I'm just a little short guy. I'm not a short preacher because I preach forever on and on and on, but I'm a short guy. And Esau is not happy. Mom and Dad kind of have this figured out, and so they said to Jacob, said, you know what, Jacob, you need to head off eastward. You got an uncle. Go get a wife there. So Jacob does that, and he goes to his uncle Laban. Isn't family great? Uncle Laban, he meets up and he sees Rachel. He's like, ooh la la, got to have her. And so he makes this deal with Laban, his uncle, to marry her. And now the deceiver is deceived because Laban, after 7 years, he said, okay, 7 years. You work for me 7 years, she's all yours. Dude. You know, and the scripture says is that he worked those 7 years, and it was like, man, it was like 3 days. Went quick. And it's wedding day. Obviously, they don't do weddings like we do. You know, those veils, you couldn't really see a whole lot. And so what Uncle Laban does is he's got an older daughter that he's pretty sure, and she must be not that good looking, and so he's got to get her married off. You know, I don't know what her deal was, but he's got to get her married off, and the only chance he's going to do that is if he sneaks it in on Jacob. And so he does. Covers up, and Jacob goes in, and they get married, takes the veil off, and the next morning, what a surprise. Okay? It's Leah. And I remember studying this when I was first Christian, and she had big brown eyes. It was like cow eyes. I don't know why this study talked about that. Just for what it's worth. That's free, okay? So he works another 7 years with Laban to win and earn the bride he wanted, Rachel. Then that's 14 years he's there, and then Laban convinces him to stay another 6 years, to stay with him another 6 years, and Jacob's getting homesick. Wants to go home. By the way, when I said that the blessing when secured by manipulation is no blessing, you understand what I'm saying? There he was. He was out being deceived, and he's not even at home. What good did it do him? Are you following? Okay. This is cool, isn't it? Don't you love it when I just tell you the story instead of read it to you? By the way, you can read it for yourself. Please do. So he decides to go home. Has some problems with that with Laban, but they get it worked out. And Laban finally gives him his blessings. And on his way, on his way home, 20 years later, he discovers that he's got to face his past. Time to come face to face with these sins. What he discovers, and the word comes back as he's headed home, and he's getting closer, is that his brother Esau has 400 fighting men, soldiers, if you will, headed towards him. And it's like, uh-oh. Okay? Uh-oh. And he is somewhat humbled by this time, and he devises a plan, and he's a wealthy man, and he devises a plan, and he sends gifts out kind of in waves to his brother. Sends out some cattle, sends out donkeys. He sends out different gifts to his brother, some servants, gives him some servants, and his brother is seeing, this massive clan, literally hundreds of people. And as they're incoming, and Jacob kind of reserves his close part of his family to the back of the caravan. And as they go in, he's getting ready. Now, what you need to know is that when Jacob was headed to his uncle's 20 years earlier, he stopped at a place where God met with him, and it was called Jacob's Ladder. Okay. And he discovered that he was in the house of God, and that God visited with him. And he realized that it was bigger than him. In fact, the stone he set up, he said, God was in this place and I didn't even know it. And he determined then that he would start trying to follow God, probably still under his own steam. And he says, I'll tithe. By the way, we can't buy our way in with God. That doesn't work. That isn't why we tithe. But he starts tithing, he starts doing that. He calls the place the house of God, and he knows that God has visited him. Now he's 20 years later, he's coming back, and he's in the same area. Okay, I don't know that it's exactly the same place. And he puts his family across the brook of Jacob. And his family's there, and he's obviously come to some terms with God. And he decides that he's going to stay by himself and he's going to pray. Not a bad plan. And God meets with him. And that night, he wrestles with God. Isn't it interesting? Still wrestling, still trying. But this time, he really wants the blessing. And they wrestle with God all night long, and God touches him, knocks his hip out of socket. He actually goes limping into his brother. And God says to him, he says to God, he said, I will not let you go. I will not let loose of you until I am blessed by you. Now, he's not being arrogant. There's a huge change in this guy. You say, Pastor, how you know that if he's not letting go and he's telling God? He wasn't really telling God. What he was is desperate. He's begging God. You say, how do you know that, Pastor? Well, read it. read it. And when he gets done, he renames the place to Peniel, or something like that, which means wrestled with God. That it also can be translated that I wrestled with God, I met with God, and I lived. What I love about this is that there's some names that they begin to ask each other names, and Jacob asks God what his name is, and God doesn't tell him, but God asks him what his name is, and he says, my name is Jacob, and he said, not anymore. From now on, you're going to be known as Israel, the Prince. Are you with me? The Prince of God. How cool is that? By the way, I'm almost done. I like telling the story. What do I want to suggest to you? I don't even know what my notes say next, Tim. Good luck with that. And if they don't match, make them match. All right? What I want you to understand is that when we try to do things under our own steam instead of trusting God, we do ourselves a disservice. Too often in the church, too often in the world, both are guilty of doing it. We try to take hold of circumstances and situations, and we desperately want the blessings of God, we desperately want the birthright, but we don't want to do it God's way. Amen? I see that on social media with Facebook. Well, God loves everybody. Yeah, he does. But there's still judgment day. And if you don't know him as your Lord and Savior, and if you don't come through Jesus Christ, if you don't get that birthright, you don't get in. That's just the truth. But too often people in the world are trying to find some other way around to heaven and to God. And there's no other way. Jesus said it himself. I am the way. I am the truth. And I am the life. And no man, women too, children, doesn't matter, can come to the Father except through me. You get your birthright by coming to Christ and asking and doing what Jacob had to do, look at his past and deal with it, his past sins. You have to deal with the sin problem. And that's why the cross, by the way, to take care of the sin problem. I also see it in the church. For some of us who have taken care of the sin problem, and then we find ourselves on some days where we want to take hold and we want to get the blessings. We see it crop up in the church in all kinds of ways. Let me see how I wrote it out. I like the way I wrote it out. But what I'm really talking about is that there are too many people in the church who somehow think, well, if there's this formula for God, and if I can just get the formula right and I can just do the right things, then God is forced to do whatever. Let me give you an example that comes to mind just off the top of my head. I'm thinking of the verse that says, if my people who are called by my name will humble themselves and pray, then I will hear them, and then I will hear their land. And people think, well, if I just do that, then everything is fixed. That's not what the verse says. But too many people think, well, if you just do that. There are other times when you come in and I've met folks and all we got to do is pray and fast. And if we just do that long enough and hard enough, that God will do what we're expecting him to do. We don't say that. But we anticipate that, which means we're guilty. If I just pray, if I just fast, and I just do it for enough days, then God's going to come and he's going to do whatever we think he's going to do. And the church too often does that. Or we think that there's a, you know, that if I work hard enough, or if I'm good enough, or if I'm humble enough, or what I want to say to you is that what was taking place there with Jacob as he wrestled with God is that Jacob understood that he was in the presence of love, he was in the presence of mercy, he was in the presence of God's grace. And that as he went forward, the only way that he was going to truly be blessed by God, and he said, I am not going to let you go. Oh, God, I'm begging you for your blessings. But he came to a point in his life when he understood that if he was going to be truly blessed, then it wouldn't be by his own endeavors. It wouldn't be by his own attempts. It would be by him letting go and trusting God to do it for him. But the good news is that God is more than willing to give us grace and to bless us. Isn't that great news? Let me read this to you in closing. This is from Paul. It's in his letter to Ephesians. It's the second chapter. He writes, as for you, you were dead in your transgressions and sins, in which you used to live when you followed the ways of this world and the ruler of the kingdom of the air, the spirit who is now at work in those who are disobedient. All of us also lived among them at one time, gratifying the cravings of our flesh and following its desires and thoughts like the rest. We were by nature deserving wrath, but because of his great love for us, God, who is rich in mercy, made us alive with Christ. Hallelujah. Even when we were dead in transgressions. It is by grace you have been saved, and God raised us up with Christ and seated us with him in the heavenly realms in Christ Jesus, in order that in the coming ages he might show the incomparable riches of his grace, expressed in his kindness to us in Christ Jesus. He says it again, for it is by grace you have been saved through faith, and this is not from yourselves, it is the gift of God, and not by works, so that no one can boast. For we are God's handiwork, created in Christ Jesus to do good works, which God prepared in advance for us to do. I think those outside the church have think that they have it all figured out. There are those inside the church who pick it up and is trying to get to the top or the blessings. I just remind you, no birthright, no hope of blessing. And the blessings are on God's terms. Just come to him. Like the loving Father that he is. He is more eager to bless your life than you can ever imagine, but on his terms. So let me ask you, have you come to the end of yourself? Are you tired of trying to make it happen? Are you tired of trying to manipulate God? Will you surrender? If you do, you can experience the grace that Jacob experienced and the mercy that Jacob experienced and the love that Jacob experienced. I can't imagine. Here's a guy who went from trying to make it all happen so much so that he is willing to lie, cheat, and steal to get it, to finding it when he finally comes to God and says, I'm yours. I need it. Please, please, I beg you, bless me. And what I find so amazing is that the amazing grace, songwriter had it right, amazing grace, the amazing grace and love that God showed to that weasel. Isn't it cool? Where are you? Try and do it on your own? Don't. Please, do yourself a favor. Don't. Bring it to God. God is anxious to bless you. It's not a formula. It's just, I know his love, okay? I know his love. Thanks, Matt, for keeping up with me back there with the camera. No charge for all the exercise. You did good, Tim. God loves you. God wants to bless you. He just does. You say, well, Pastor Carl, how do you know that? It's not a formula. His word tells me that God so loved the world that he gave his only son, that whosoever. I don't know how to wrap this thing up exactly, but if you need prayer, you want to pray, this is a good time at the close. Nellie, why don't you come on up and play, if you will, sweetie. Thank you. And Judy, you're not on the cameras, so why don't you come on up. Judy will be happy to pray with you. Shannon, you're one of our prayers. Why don't you take the other side over here? I won't even embarrass you. I'll let people go out, and it's just you and them and God. And they keep their mouths shut. They keep the secrets, okay? They're just here to help guide in prayer, okay? We miss the hustlers, really. I usually make them do all this, but I'm making you guys do double duty. It's all right. Would you stand with me? I want to pray for you guys. What a God we have. What a God we have. Brother Gary, I should let you go. Go ahead and make your way back there, if you will. Yeah, he's going to collect them. Almighty God, I just come to you. These are my people. These are the people you've given me to do watch care and spiritual growth and spiritual development. And they matter to me. They're precious. This has been, for me, Lord, just an exciting time. I feel so loved by this group of people. I feel so blessed. I came here not knowing what to expect a few years ago, and what I discovered, Lord, is you have blessed my socks off. I'm a blessed man. All because I've come to you and I just surrender to your guidance and your will and your ways. Now, there are days, Lord, when I confess that I want to pick it up. And I find it hard. I have a hunch that there's a lot in my church that are somewhat like that, wrestling. I want them to have the blessings of God, Lord, and so I pray for them. If there's anyone in here today, Lord, who doesn't have the birthright that comes from knowing Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior, may today be their day. Bless us as we go out into the world. Help us, Lord, to change the makeup of eternity. All for your glory and all for your honor. And for those who may not know you, Lord, we want them to know you. And all the people of God said, amen and amen.